spear. You're the nail on the cross. You're the fly in my beer. You're the key that got lost. You're the letter from Jesus on the bathroom wall. You're murder superior with only a bra. You're the same, you're the same, you're the same kind of man as me. You're the same kind of man as me. I'm the head on the bed. I'm the coffee instead. I'm the fish that could bait. I'm the detective of late. I'm the blood on the floor, the thunder and the roar. I'm the boat that won't sink. I just won't sleep a wink. You're the same kind of bed as me. You're the same kind of bed as me. You're the same kind of bed as me. You're the same kind of bed as me.
No good, you say? Well, that's good enough for me.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Loudini Rock and Roll Circus Music Podcast with Lou Lombardi, a.k.a. Loudini, and the lovely and talented Miss Katie Simone.
Hi, everyone.
So what's going on there, pretty lady?
I'm hungover.
You're hung- I thought your tooth hurt. I thought you had a toothache.
It's both.
Both?
I have both. Well, I mean, I was drinking because of the toothache, and now I got a headache and a toothache.
Surely for medicinal purposes.
Oh, yes.
Yes. I'm just trying to keep you from...
From popping.
Too much popping. Pop, 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 poppity pop.
Pop and locking.
Pop and locking. So Katie's been busy. She's gigging all over the place.
I am.
I just wanted to tell you guys, since we do promote... indie acts and unsigned acts, etc. We saw a very cool band the other night here, real close by to where we record the podcast at Frankie Eyes Network.
And they were badass.
Those SOBs could lay down some serious 70s pop and rock, great vocals.
That's right. Yeah.
I mean, you know, what band does Feels Like the First Time by Foreigner?
And what band does Wet Willy? I'm still not over the Keep On Smiling cover.
I know. I mean, they did stuff like they did Hall & Oates. They did all kind of very cool stuff. It was a good time. We had a lot of fun and drinks akimbo.
Yeah, that Frankie Eyes is the truth. I like that place. It's the truth. It's a cool rock and roll bar.
Speaking of cool rock and roll, let's lay down a little bit. This is a friend of yours. We're gonna play
one of my best friends. Yes. I love this guy to pieces.
Anthony is a great dude, and I interviewed him about a year ago, and he's just a sweetheart of a guy. This is from his album Electric Field Holler. This is Red Handed Blues. Anthony Gomes on the Loudini Rock and Roll Circus.
Last Friday night, Johnny's getting married, had to send him off right. Told the girls we were going to the fishing hole, but we went to the nightclub where the girls dance on a pole. We partied all night long and headed back on our way, but waiting in the parking lot was Johnny's fiance. Not like we planned it, Lord, what we gonna do? We're so busted, she's disgusted, heaven help us through. Don't tell her white lies, now you can color me true. Got caught red-handed, got the red-handed blues. Yeah, yeah, red-handed blues. Johnny to the floor, said this ain't right. Smelling like cheap perfume, morning of our wedding night. He said, I'm sorry, baby, I'll never tell another lie. She said, how you ever gonna look a preacher in the eye? He said, take me to that preacher now and dump me in the
so busted, she's disgusted. Heaven help us through. Don't tell her white lies, now you can color me true. Got caught red-handed, got the red-handed blues. Yeah, yeah, red-handed blues. Oh, so busted, baby.
All right, Mr. Anthony Gomes there with Red-Handed Blues. Some cool lyrics there. That is anthonygomes.com. If you can check out everything that Anthony's got going on, he's playing constantly. They tour. I think he told me they go out like 4 days a week and then come back. So they're always playing around the U.S. So go check them out, anthonygomes.com. We got started before I thanked my sponsor.
Oh, good job, Lou.
Real quick, Positively Pittsburgh Live Magazine, pplmag.com. That's Pittsburgh's first internet radio, TV network, and online community magazine business directory. You can listen to, watch, download, and get emails with the latest audio and video created by the members of the community. You can read articles, grab coupons, find businesses, and you can even start your own magazine page. No, Katie, not that kind of magazine.
Oh.
No, Playgirl.
You guys don't let me have any fun.
You can write your own articles and upload your own video and audio.
What kind of video?
See? See, right into the gutter. See, we're not even 5 minutes, 10 minutes into this, and we're already in the gutter. That's a pplmag.com. It's a great place if you've got something you want to share with the world. They get about 1 million unique visitors every month, so it's a cool place to get your stuff out there. That is pplmag.com. Now, why are we listening to this? Because on this day in rock and roll history, this album came out. Appetite for Destruction by Guns N' Roses. And it was a... They're not really hair metal. Although
no.
They had long hair.
They had big hair.
Yeah.
They had quite large hair. It was quite large and quite teased.
But they don't really sound like Poison.
No, they don't.
Who did the Cherry Pie song?
Warrant.
They don't really have that.
They don't sound like Dawkins, okay?
Or Firehouse or those sort of bands. They had like kind of an edgier sort of blues-based type sound.
They're almost kind of Stonesy.
Stones, Aerosmith.
Yeah.
Black Crowes. Was the Black Crowes out before or after?
After. Like the Crowes kind of got bigger like in the early 90s.
Okay. So these guys are like pre-Black Crowes, but mm-hmm. But this is a great album, and I remember hearing it and just kind of realizing, oh, you know, this is something different. So we're going to celebrate a little bit of this record with you guys today. There's some... we're going to share a little article that I found on NME.com. 25 things that you probably did not know about this album. Appetite for Destruction by Guns N' Roses. You know, the original artwork for the album was a stomach-turning, gruesome affair image based on Robert Williams' painting of the same title that depicts a girl with her pants around her ankles, a robot rapist, and a metal avenging angel about to take revenge. And the Geffen label said no. So Axl Rose says, wait a minute, how about we just put a picture of the space shuttle blowing up? See, these are how rock and rollers think, you know what I mean?
Because
they're just like out there, you know,
like, oh, we got a record deal. Oh wait, but that's not cool, so here's what we're gonna do.
Let's mess it all up.
Yeah, let's just ruin everything.
Before it even comes out. Paul Stanley was one of the people that was that the guys had were interested in having produce the album with them. That on these great records, we talked about, you know, all kind of albums about how different people came into the project but then weren't able to complete it or had to leave. You know, that seems to be a story, you know, a sort of like a recurring idea. Axl might take eons to turn up to his gigs, but the band had a knack for writing songs at super speed. Slash claims that Welcome to the Jungle was penned in just 3 hours.
3 hours?
3 hours.
I wouldn't have expected it to take that long. I mean, it's a great song, but it's not like prolific, you know?
it's a cool jam.
It's a great tune.
What are you trying to say?
No, I was thinking that I would have pegged it like a 15-minute tune. Like,
See, this is how good. So anybody out there is looking for a vocalist / songwriter, you want to call Katie because she can crank out something like that in 15 minutes.
Well, I'm just saying, like, whenever you know how you hear about all these legendary songs and stuff, and like they always say, "Oh, it took like 10 minutes," or "I wrote it in the car." Like, I kind of would have like gotten that vibe from that song.
Well, I'm not completely sure, but the understanding I have is that that's like, that's how it worked. Okay, mm-hmm. Lyrics to Mr. Brownstone, none too subtle heroin allusions were roughly jotted down on the back of a grocery bag.
That's what I'm talking about. Like on the napkin at the bar, 5 minutes, we're done. Okay, that's another hit.
Yeah, here we are, another hit. Let's just crank on. Classic tearjerker, November Rain, would have appeared in Appetite for Destruction, but the band decided to save it for a later LP as they had already had Sweet Child of Mine and didn't want to include more than one ballad. You know, that's a mistake that, I don't know. Like, I think that, like, Def Leppard did Hysteria, and I think that they sort of became like a ballad band, like Night Ranger, you know what I mean? And, like, while they had great rock tunes, those songs got pushed aside because, you know, the record labels push the ballads. It's a probably smart idea. Other iconic Guns N' Roses songs that could have ended up on the album were You Could Be Mine and Don't Cry.
I love Don't Cry. Yeah, that's one of my favorite Gene Autry songs.
Yeah, but You Could Be Mine, I always thought that was a really great, great jam. Speaking of Sweet Child of Mine, Guns N' Roses have been pretty scathing about arguably their best love song of the years. In addition to claiming that it started life as a joke, they also denounced it as filler and circus music. So
wasn't that just one of Slash's exercises or something like that?
Yeah.
He was just like, you know, doing some kind of like little finger exercise. Yeah.
There's a you're probably too young to appreciate the band from the 70s called Kansas.
Oh, my dad loves Kansas. You have no idea how much Kansas I had to listen to as a kid.
But the song, speaking of finger exercises that became mm-hmm. guitar riffs, the song Dust in the Wind was a finger exercise. You're Crazy was originally penned as an acoustic ditty before it was turned into a snarling rock beast. The slower stripped-down version later resurfaced on GNR Lies. Anything Goes is one of the oldest songs in the band's canon. In fact, it goes back to 81 and used to be called My Way or Your Way and was originally written when Axel and guitarist Izzy Stradlin were still in their old group Hollywood Rose. Who would have thought that Guns N' Roses would be influenced by Elton John? But according to Slash, My Michelle was written as a tribute to his and Axel's friend Michelle Young after the three of them heard Rocket Man's Your Song in a car radio, and she declared she wanted someone to pen a similar song for her too. It's not too soppy though. There's references to her mother's past in the porn industry and her own drug addiction. So you know they had to kind of rough it up a little bit, you know, because it is a Guns N' Roses record.
Again, street cred.
Street cred. Axel on Welcome to the Jungle. I wrote how LA looked to me. If someone comes to town and they want to find something, they can find whatever they want.
Mm-hmm.
That LA is a happening place. Rather than plump for traditional side A and side B structure, Appetite for Destruction is split into G and R sides. For the former Gun side, dealing with violence and debauchery, Welcome to the Jungle, Paris City, etc. While the latter, Roses side, focuses on love, sex, and whatnot. Quote, end quote. There wasn't much heart of mine, but there was a little left, and baby, you found it. Aw, how sweet. Except that Think About You wasn't written about a particular lady of mine. It's thought to be an ode to heroin. Not quite as romantic, huh? Paradise City could have ended up being a whole lot less wholesome, too. Rather than Take Me Down to the Paradise City where the grass is green and the girls are pretty, Slash preferred Take Me Down to the Paradise City where the girls are fat and they've got big titties. Well, I can say titties, right?
I think so. I mean, I like that line better. I mean, it's kind of, I think it's a little bit more rhythmic, you know?
And then finally, here's Slash explaining the heartfelt sentiment that went into So Easy. There's a lot to say for that period of time when you just start to lose the excitement of chasing chicks. You start going after really bizarre girls like librarians and stuff. Yeah, because librarians are bizarre. Just to catch them and say, I finally went out with a girl I caught that wouldn't be a normal date. What a charmer.
Hey, me and Slash got something in common. We just want the challenge.
You date librarians too?
I don't even know anymore.
You may be dating a librarian and not even know it.
I know. A librarian in the streets. Or no, a librarian in the sheets. And I don't know. There's something there.
Out to Get Me with its chorus of "They won't catch me, I'm innocent, they won't break me," deals with Axl's tendency to get into scrapes with the law when he was a rosy-cheeked youngster in Indiana.
That nice boy, no.
You know, he was a... He like taught Bible study and stuff. Like, you ever see any of the pictures?
Yeah.
No. He was like Mr. Wholesome. How different things might have been once Appetite for Destruction had hit the 200,000 sales mark. Geffen were considering cutting their losses, stopping their attempts to promote it, and forcing the band to get back in the studio for a record follow-up. Wow. Instead, it became the biggest selling debut album of all time in the U.S., flogging a massive 18 million units. He said unit.
And he said flogging. Flogging units.
And it shifted over 30 million copies shifted over 30 million copies worldwide. Reckon the bright spark at Geffen, who wanted to, you know, right? They wanted to pull it, right? Oh, you got it. You think that guy's still working at Geffen? The guy that said we got to pull it after 200,000?
He's the one bringing David Geffen coffee.
Yeah. Paradise City has a unique distinction on the album. It's the only track that uses a synthesizer.
That's crazy for an album that came out in 1987. I mean, like...
Yeah, everything was synthesizer, right?
Yeah, awesome. Everything.
Even Springsteen had gone synth.
Oh, everybody went synth. That's insane.
Earlier this year, the classic lineup to record Appetite for Destruction were inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Cue a shedload of exciting whispers that they would get together again. That is until Axl decided not to show up. As the more things change, right, the more they stay the same.
Is that in that picture down there? Is that the drummer? Is that Steven Adler?
I don't know. This guy?
Yeah. It looks like him, but he looks like a lot better. Like, he must be sober now.
I don't know. His eyes are squinting, so
well,
it's hard to tell.
I mean, he might be stoned, but, you know.
He could have been stoned. There's an interesting article also on Loudwire about the anniversary, you know, about this. But Slash tells us that you go to loudwire.com/Guns N' Roses Appetite for Destruction album anniversary. Slash tells us that actually Axl was the most sober one during the recording. He was like very concerned about his voice, so he wouldn't drink.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, he rarely partied. It was the rest of them that were all messed up. on heroin. And he said that, you know, just Axl was just, he was like very serious. He wanted the record to come out really good. He wanted his voice to sound good. I mean, you got to realize too, I mean, like in rock, I mean, the vocals have got to like be like awesome.
Oh yeah.
You know, if they're not, then it's, you know, then you're not. But Slash, here's a little quote. He says, Slash once told me, you know, you do heroin once and it's such a high, you want to do it again, says the band's former European publicist. The problem with it is that the minute you do it a second time, you're addicted to it. Axl really wasn't doing drugs because of the medication he was on. He wasn't a big drinker evil, and people have misconception about that. He was a clean and mostly sober one. He wanted to preserve his voice, and he was serious about it. Axl was the only sober one, and he was surrounded by guys that were either strung out on heroin, drugged out on pills, or out in alcoholic stupor. And that added to some of the friction in the band. Axl didn't want to be around the guys that were all effed up. So you know, some of the best rock, you know, is kind of born out of angst, and there was some angst going on, you know,
a lot
right
of tension,
there, you know. But I mean, it's just one of the most, you know, powerful records of all time, and I was really glad that. I was really grateful that I was sort of around and like into music and everything when it came out, because I remember a good friend of mine, he was a student at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor, and he calls me up, he's like, dude, have you heard this band Guns N' Roses? You know, so, you know, we went up there and I ended up hanging out at his place one night, and we were, it came on, there was a, MTV had a concert, a live concert, and they did Sweet Child of Mine, they did all these great songs, and I was just like floored at the edginess of it, you know. Up to this point, you know, music that was being played like that had a, you know, was really slick.
Mm-hmm,
you know,
very polished.
Yeah, very polished. And this was really in your face and out there, real rock and roll. So, you know, that's the thing, Katie, right? You know, just as soon as, like, the stuff starts to get too slick, somebody comes along and, like, there's a whole new thing out there, you know,
oh, yeah.
and says, no, we're going to mess this all up.
I mean, it's
like you get your hair just right and you go out in the wind.
I mean, it's like, you know, it's like fashion trends, you know, recycle themselves. Like, you know, you want to hear something that's, you know, a little bit more real. I mean, the early 90s, you know, that's when we had the grunge scene come through.
Yeah.
And this was probably too polished for their liking. You know?
I know. They probably thought, like, we wanted to be more rock and roll. Well, mm-hmm. That was one of the things. They had done some recording and didn't like the drum sound. And so this is why they went searching for a different producer, and why Paul Stanley was actually considered for a while too. So they definitely had a sound in mind for this. Now you are listening to the Loudini Rock and Roll Circus August 6th edition, and there's a couple other things we should talk about. See, this was our feature for today, so that was the Appetite for Destruction. But there are some other great records, Katie, that came out on this exact day, like not on this in this year, but we should kind of give a quick mention to this thing right here.
We don't need no education.
Oh, those boys.
Now, this wasn't the release of the album, this was the release of the movie.
Yes.
Another Brick in the Wall, and I need to go to the art little notes here and see what... If you see it before me, jump in. Oh, it was 1982.
Yeah.
Starring Bob Geldof. Opened in movie theaters in New York. The film was conceived alongside the double album Pink Floyd's Pink Floyd's Roger Waters. Very powerful film.
Absolutely.
And people are still talking about it. There's a I posted on Facebook. The Wall Analysis, or Analyzing the Wall or something, is a website all devoted completely to, like, you know, the dissection of the Wall.
Well, I mean, it's amazing. It just shows, like, what a brilliant band Pink Floyd really was. I mean, in Pittsburgh alone, you have at least once a month, you've got, you know, a big laser show devoted to Pink Floyd. I mean, and this is all over the country, all over the world. People are still going crazy for all these albums. I mean, different midnight showings of the Wall.
Yeah.
Different little indie theaters.
Yeah. You got it on Blu-ray?
I don't.
Oh, it's so good.
I need to get it.
See, you should, like, stay tonight, and, like, we should watch that. Get crazy. So that's another record that, you know, there's really, you know, a milestone in rock, one of the most important rock albums in rock of all time that was released on this day. And wait, whoops, I went the wrong way.
Good job, Lou.
I clicked the wrong button. Well, check this out. What about this song?
Is this Destiny's Child?
It is Destiny's Child.
No, they sampled it.
Just like the wild wing dove sings a song that sounds like she's singing. Ooh, ooh.
I love this record.
This also came out on this day. And again, if you see it before I do, feel free to jump in. Oh, yes, 1981. So so this came out in 81. The Wall came out in 82. Movie.
Mm-hmm.
Stevie Nicks released her first solo album, Belladonna. And this was, we got to hear Stevie in a more rocking environment in some instances on this, like this and Stop Dragging My Heart Around, you know.
Oh, yeah. Now, there's some incredible songs on this. I love Jimmy Iovine. Like, I love his, that sound he got. And she was, like, Stevie was so obsessed with Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers. Like, if you ever watch, like, any interviews with her talking about Petty, she was like, I wanted to be in the band, and Petty's like, we don't have any chicks in the Heartbreakers. So she just went ahead and got his producer, just to get that Damn the Torpedoes sound. He produced Patti Smith, too. But yeah, Jimmy Iovine and Stevie Nicks are like a match made in heaven as far as sound goes.
This is a dynamite album, and something that people don't know is that Stop Dragging My Heart Around, there was a Tom Petty song, and I can't remember which one it was.
It was Insider.
Okay. Came out at the same time, and the record label said we can't have two Tom Petty songs at the top of the chart. So Tom Petty, they sort of sacrificed Tom Petty for Stevie Nicks, although they both...
Oh, no, it wasn't Insider. It was A Woman in Love.
A Woman in Love. And, but...
Same album.
But the song, it has Petty sing, and it has all the Heartbreakers playing, and the video is the Heartbreakers, you know.
Yeah.
So she got her fantasy.
Yeah, she got what she wanted.
to be in the Heartbreakers, at least for a song. So congratulations, the dynamite album, Belladonna. One of my favorite records, really important record for me growing up. I heard that, and that blew my mind. Speaking of mind-blowing music, let's go ahead and play another Loudini artist. This is a very cool, sort of bluesy, rootsy artist, Karen Lovely, off her album 10 Miles of Something. 10 Miles of Bad Road. Company Graveyard, Karen Lovely on the Loudini Rock and Roll Circus.
Thank you.
All right, that is a young lady named Karen Lovely. And let me go ahead and promote Karen a little wee bit here. That is KarenLovely.com. And Karen is a great sort of like rootsy, bluesy artist. And you definitely want to check her out, playing all over the place.
Yeah, she's got a lot of shows.
Yeah, yeah, working real hard. Canada, all over the place. So California, Louisville.
Louisville.
I played in a band with, you know Patrick Duff?
I've met him before,
I think.
He's
from Kentucky, but, you know, he's like, it's Louisville. He's a good guy. Anyways, Karen Lovely, you want to go to KarenLovely.com, and you can check out everything she has going on there. Let's go ahead and jump into this day in music. You know, I should have grabbed the sound sample for this because it would have been great. But in 1960, Chubby Checker on this day appeared on the U.S. TV show American Bandstand and performed "Come On Baby, Let's Do the Twist." Exactly. 63 on this day, Studio A, Columbia Recording Studio in New York. Bob Dylan recorded his first session produced by Tom Wilson for the album "The Time They Are Changing." Dylan's third studio album was the first collection to feature only original compositions, the title track being one of Dylan's most famous. The album consists mostly of stark, sparsely arranged story songs concerning issues such as racism, poverty, and social change. And Stevie, we're going to back you down a little wee bit, honey. Okay.
Nobody put Stevie in a corner.
I know. Why don't you tell us, because it wouldn't be a Loudini Rock and Roll Circus without these guys.
Oh, God, these guys.
These guys. You know what I mean? Like, what are they, like prima donnas or something?
Yeah, who do they think they are? 1963, the Beatles arrived in Jersey, in the Channel Islands, where they spent the day go-karting and relaxing by the pool at the Revere Hotel before playing the first of four nights at the Springfield Ballroom. Sorry, get me on the Jersey accent.
Nice.
I can't stop.
Some fans
had found out where they were staying, but they were happy to chat and be photographed with them. Wow. Oh, that was before people were really crazy. Can you imagine trying to do that today?
I know. And on this day in 64, Rod Stewart made his TV debut with on the Beat Room as a member of the Hoochie Coochie Men. The Beatles released their fifth album this day in 65 and soundtrack to their second film, Help. Decca Records on this day in 65 released Small Faces debut. What you gonna do about
That's
it?
That's a great song, by the way, and if you are so inclined, look up the Pretenders cover of it. It's very good.
Oh, cool. We should get together on this stuff ahead of time. Ready to go.
It's pretty cool.
Oh, wait a minute. I want to say something real quick. Can we do this? You know this song?
Oh, I know it well.
Happy birthday to one half of the band Timbuk 3. Pat McDonald was born on this day in 1952. Future So Bright. This is their one hit wonder, but it's like an infectious song.
Oh, it's a great tune.
So happy birthday to you guys. Why don't you tell everybody about... why don't you tell everybody about this? Whoops. This... Let's not highlight the whole website. Go ahead.
In this day in 1973, Stevie Wonder was seriously injured in the car he was riding in. I almost said driving, and that was horrible.
Yeah. You know how Stevie Wonder drives a car, don't you?
I don't know how.
One hand on the wheel, one hand on the road.
That's horrible.
Only on the Loudini Rock and Roll Circus. We hear the bad taste jokes.
I'm telling you. God, I feel like I need to go to confession after that.
Stop. You should hear the jokes she says when we're not recording.
No, I'm a nice girl. What are you talking about? So I guess Stevie ran into some a bad situation in 73 when the car he was riding in crashed into a truck on I-85 near Winston-Salem, leaving him in a coma for 4 days. Oh, no. And it left him without any sense of smell. Oh, man, that guy, like...
Bummer. This doesn't have the sight now. He loses the smell. I can't smell anything.
On a side note, they're not to go off track. Have you ever seen the posters of Stevie Wonder? Like, he did like some kind of anti-drunk driving campaign in the 80s, and he said, it said something like, I'd sooner drive a car than get into one with a drunk person behind the wheel.
No,
that's powerful. Powerful.
As they say in Pittsburgh, pretty powerful.
It's pretty powerful, pretty stuff.
Powerful. Pretty powerful. We already talked about Stevie. We already talked about these people. We talked about Appetite for Destruction. Adam Clayton of U2 on this day in 1989 was arrested in the Blue Light Inn. The Blue Light Inn car park in Dublin for marijuana possession and intent to supply. It wasn't like he was dealing, he was intent to supply. He probably said, oh, I'm gonna give it to my friend too. And you know what I mean, so they're probably gonna
get my band stoned.
What's the matter with people anyway? So he was busted, but what he did was he gave some money to a women's aid center. I don't understand. You understand pounds and all that jazz? I don't know what that means.
It's like a little bit more. It's a little less than American dollars, I guess.
It's a little less than American dollars?
I think. I don't know. I'm not very well traveled.
What? What?
You can't. No, you spell it. There you go.
No, I found it. I found it because.
That's not her.
Oh, that's the Lush Life. We have to do this because, like, I can't believe that I missed this. In the notes when I was... Did I spell it right?
No. Switch the E and the O.
Oh. O before E. Unless it sounded like lobe. But you remember this song?
Oh, this is a great song.
You say I only hear what I want to.
I have a great story about Lisa Loeb. You want to hear my Lisa Loeb story? Anyways, we should just say this real quick. On this day, Lisa Loeb started a 3-week run at number one in the U.S. singles charts with this amazing song. Here's my Lisa Loeb story. We played the Regatta when the song was big, and we covered it. She was like the big headlining act that day. She played in the afternoon, and we just assumed she was gone. No, she was there. She heard our show, and somebody passed us an autographed glossy with her say, "Thank you for playing my song."
That is so cool.
It was awesome. It was like, whoa. We were like, oh my, we're totally blown away.
That is so cool.
Yeah, it was very cool. Lisa Loeb. I just like this song. You know what I mean?
It is a great tune.
Okay, here. Speaking of sisters, just give this one real quick. Then we'll do the one you want. Speaking of sisters making it big here.
Sisters doing it for themselves?
Yes.
2001, Whitney Houston became one of the highest paid musicians in the world after signing a new deal with Arista Records said to be worth more than $100 million. And she was dead 11 years later.
I know. And the thing is, and people had like no clue what was about to come.
Nope. Oh.
You know what I mean? Like Michael Jackson and who's the country? Garth Brooks. I mean, Whitney Houston, they signed these huge, like, in fact, Garth Brooks' deal is so big that to this day, he's not allowed to say what it is.
Really?
That's how big his deal is.
She's a man.
And then, you know, fast forward about 8 years.
Yeah.
It's like, poof, it evaporated. What did you want to talk about?
In 2004, Rick James passed away. He was found dead in his Los Angeles home. What happened? I guess it was something involving cocaine.
No, not Rick.
not Rick. No, I love Rick James.
Jokes made by that comedian. What's his name?
That's just Dave Chappelle. That's just Chappelle just being an idiot. No, but R.I.P. Rick. I still miss you.
I know. Rest in peace, the mighty Rick James. I want to just throw a couple birthday shout outs. A couple birthday shut-ups. This is one of my favorite guitar players in the entire world. On this day in 1948, Alan Holdsworth, the maniac, he looks like Mr. Rogers, but he plays like Satan. Alan Holdsworth was born on this day. We got to do this. We got to do this too. Guess who else was born? Let me get back to my thing. I lost my thing. Katie, say something funny while I find my thing. Here's my thing.
Your face.
I got to find my thing.
Your thing?
I need my thing. Here we are. What about this song? This guy was born.
I love this song. Oh my God.
This takes me back to prom.
I love this song so much. This is one of my favorite cheesy 80s songs.
When it feels like the world is on your shoulders and all of the madness has got you going crazy, it's time to get out, step out into the street where all of the action is right there at your feet. Well, I know a place where we can dance the whole night away.
We're like totally like
grooving. We're grooving.
What do you guys, when we start doing video for this, you guys are going to really love this.
Until the morning light, forget about the worries on your mind. You can leave them all behind.
Okay, happy birthday to El DeBarge. Randy DeBarge.
Randy DeBarge,
born on this day in 1958, a big hit in 1985 with the year I graduated high school. Goodness gracious. And I think we got one more person we have to give a salute to here. Oh, yeah. I heard this. I was at a wedding, and I just heard this song.
Tell you what I want, what you really, really want. So tell me what you want, what you really, really want. I'll tell you what I want, what I really, really want.
Happy birthday to Jerry Holloway from the Spice Girls.
I gotta tell you my story about the Spice Girls.
Tell me a Spice Girls song. We've had stories tonight about every song.
Well, I mean, I was born in 90, so I was like the perfect age for the Spice Girls when they broke. Like, I was like, you know, 7 or 8 years old, so I was like, they're so cool. So me and my friends, we would all pretend to be the Spice Girls, and I wanted to be Jerry. I wanted to be Ginger, because I was a Ginger. And there was this one new girl in like our friend group, and she wanted to be Ginger too.
Uh-oh.
And I beat her up.
No.
I did. I didn't. I was like, listen, bitch. I'm sorry. Am I not allowed to say that?
Wow.
Well, I mean, that's the term for a female dog, so I should be allowed to say it. But yeah, no, I didn't take well to that. Like, you don't. I'm Ginger. That's it.
Born on the
same. I still am. If you're out there listening.
In 1972, Jerry Halliwell. It's the Ginger Spice on vocals there. Big hit. You know, every teenage boy's dream was to get at least one Spice Girl.
Mm-hmm.
So, as you're listening to Loudini Rock and Roll Circus, we're gonna come back. We'll back announce this. This is a really amazing singer songwriter from Israel, Hagar Levy, and I met Hagar recently. She's a lovely young lady and really talented. I'm interested to play this for you, Katie. This is her song called Hectic. Hagar Levy on the Loudini Rock and Roll Circus.
See.
All right, Hagar Levy from her self-titled debut, Hagar Levy, Hectic, and you can get that on iTunes. you can throw her website out there for you folks. We had a great talk. She's really wonderful. A young lady, Hagar Levy, HagarLevy.com. Anthony Gomes opened us up tonight, AnthonyGomes.com. And Karen Lovely was in there too, KarenLovely.com. Great artists, really proud to feature them and talk about them and have them part of the Loudini Rock and Roll Circus. Katie, why don't you tell us what you got coming up, what's going on for you?
What's today?
Today is August the 6th.
August 6th. What do I have going on? This coming week, I'm playing four nights in a row. 4 days in a row. the only shows really of note, they're all of note. Saturday in Greensburg with my 80s band, Ridgemont High, so at the Prospect Lounge at the Greensburg Ramada. It's always a good time. Then the next morning / afternoon, I will be in Wheeling at the Heritage Blues Festival with my blues band. We're going to be doing a short set of all original material.
Nice.
I don't really sing a lot of blues anymore, but this will be fun.
Awesome. And what is that website where they can follow up with you?
It's www.katiesimonemusic.com.
Very cool. KatieSimoneMusic.com. Guys, want to check that out? Guys, you're listening to Loudini Rock and Roll Circus. You want to go to LoudiniRockAndRollCircus.com for all your Loudini needs. Every Thursday and every Tuesday and every Thursday, there's a new interview. And every Saturday, there's a new music podcast with Katie and I. I have some very cool... I just booked some very cool interviews with a jazz guitarist, legendary jazz guitarist, Larry Coryell, and I can't believe, like, I just... This guy's...
You okay there, bud?
There's certain like artists from the 70s whose music like I just gotta hear like every few months. I dig out their greatest hits and play it over and over. You know, people like Seals and Crofts, you know, people like that. So and one of those people is England Dan and John Ford Coley. And I'm getting
What was their song?
They did a whole bunch of Really Love to See You Tonight. They did this Todd Rundgren Love Is the Answer.
Yes.
But I'm getting to interview John Ford Coley as well. So there's some very cool interviews coming up soon. So you definitely want to check that out. That's LoudiniRockAndRollCircus.com. If you like the bands and artists that we are promoting here, I encourage you to go to supportindierock.com where you can get involved and help us get the word out about these amazing acts like Karen Lovely, like Anthony Gomes, like Hagar Levy. You definitely want to participate. I know you like this kind of music, so jump in and become a part of the Loudini Rock and Roll Circus. One more shout out to my sponsor, Positively Pittsburgh Live Magazine. That is pplmag.com. Go there, buy everything, do everything they have, and you will be very happy. Hey, thank you, Mike, to my lovely and talented co-host, Miss Katie Simone.
Oh, well, thank you, Lou. Thank you, all of you out there in Radio Land.
We love you.
I love you so much.
And just real quick, next Saturday I will be playing opening for the Honey Riders.
I love them. You know what? Mark reached out to me to do that gig, like to be on that gig, and I was already booked. I'm like, damn it, because I really like them a lot.
Because he was like, do you know any bands? And I called
And then
you
called me. I'm like, is this for the Honey Riders? Because they already talked to me, and I can't do it, which bums me out. But
yeah, so anyways, I interviewed Mark.
Yeah.
So I'm going to be playing that gig with Timmy Klatt from the TurboSonics. So it's going to be like a hipster gig with acoustic guitar and drums. So that'll be fun. And then Honey Riders will be headlining. So that is Smiling Moose, August 13th. So you guys, that's next Saturday. You want to check that out. Guys, thanks so much for listening. LoudiniRockAndRollCircus.com is where you want to go. And I think that's pretty much it. You got anything else you want to add before we roll out of here, Katie?
I'm out of beer.
Okay, well that means we've come to the official end of the podcast then. Guys, thanks so much for listening. Loudini Rock and Roll Circus.com is the website for everything you need. And we will catch you guys on the next podcast.
You skid in the rain. You're trying to shift. You're grinding the gears. You're trying to shift. And you're the same kind of bad as me.